Now, I'm not one to go on about Clive Sinclair and his associated products. Yeah, so maybe I am. But given that, the ZX80 and its better-selling successor, the ZX81, are tremendously important pieces of the home micro jigsaw puzzle. Without them, we'd probably be all stuck in the 80s still, driving around with permed hair, in Audi Quattros, Renault 9s, and trying to work out what these fangled Commodore things from across the pond were. Essentially, without Sinclair, we'd be behind the times as Bulgaria. So we all owe a huge debt of gratitude to our Lord Commander and his fine creations, and to honour this, let's take a minute's silence. Oh, every bloody time! Ironically, the ZX81 didn't feature the iconic loading sound when feeding boarded data from your WH Smith tape deck into the tiny door wedge moulded computers, and the banded lines were actually an interference quirk as the video signal was hooked up to the same ULA pin as the tape output. Still, it's a nice effect. But back in 1980, these machines actually didn't feature a lot of things we'd come to associate with a standard part of the 80s micro. And other than their earliness in the scene, the main reason for that was price. These machines were designed to come under the golden price point of 100 English pounds. Back when Sinclair Research was a glint in Clive's eye whilst managing his previous company, Sinclair Electronics, Clive had dreamt of an affordable home micro that everyone could buy into. It wasn't until that company failed and Clive had started up his new enterprise that this vision was made into a reality. Following on from a home microcomputer kit called the MK14, Clive released the ZX80, the first home computer available in the UK for under £100. Ready built, and only £79 in kit form. The machine was based around the Zilog Z80 CPU and utilised readily available TTL chips. To keep costs down, the case was vacuum moulded and a dead feeling membrane keyboard was utilised, although many replacement cases and even stick-on keyboards sought to remedy this. The ROM lacked floating point arithmetic and the machine's video output was half based in software and therefore driven by CPU. This meant the screen would literally cut out to register key presses. Nevertheless, the system sold 100,000 units and kickstarted the UK's home micro scene during its 1980 launch. Only a year later, Sinclair, or more accurately, Chief Engineer Jim Westwood and his team had developed the technology enough to squeeze the ZX80's TTL chips into a semi-custom ULA package. They had also incorporated an NMI generator which allowed the hardware to operate in slow mode and therefore stopped the screen flicker on key presses. The ROM was also expanded from 4 to 8 kilobytes by a company called 9 Tiles, allowing floating point arithmetic, new commands and additional devices to be plugged in. Although the new ROM allowing decimal points did create an error in the form of a square root of 0.25 being returned as 1.3591409 rather than 0.5 as it should be. To top it off, Sinclair also splashed out on a black injection molded case, although retained the membrane keyboard. The result of this was the Sinclair ZX81. Sold at an even lower price than the ZX80, at just £49.95 in kit form and £69.95 fully assembled. This equates to about £250 in today's money. The dimensions of this tiny little package are just 6.6 inches by 1.6 inches high and it weighs just 350 grams. You'll note that I mixed up both measurement systems there just to keep everyone happy both sides of the pond. Sinclair was always very keen on design and this particular one brought its designer, Rick Dickinson, a Design Council Award. The ZX81 had 1 kilobyte of base memory, the same as the 80, but was expandable to 64 kilobyte using plug-in RAM packs on the back, which notoriously needed sticking on with blue tack to prevent them falling out at the slightest jiggle, and at worst, frying the motherboard. Graphics were provided at 24 lines by 32 characters, or 64 by 48 pixels in graphics mode. These modes were output using a standard RF plug which you could tune into your television. The output is monochrome only. The machine included Sinclair Basic as its standard language and operating system. The basic commands were accessible using shortcut key functions, which could be accessed using a variety of shift and function key pressings. This saved memory, as an entire basic command could be held in one ROM reference character byte, rather than several if typed words were utilized. Programs are loaded into and saved at 50 baud using the ear and mic sockets hooked up to a standard cassette recorder. Power is provided by a 9V DC adapter, some of which were recalled due to overheating on the early releases. Now, launching on the 5th of March 1981, initially, as with most Sinclair products, there were manufacture issues with the company tasked with its production, Timex Corporation, from its Dundee factory. This meant that it sometimes took up to 9 weeks to meet the mail order demand, although ZX80 owners could simply upgrade their machine through installation of a £20 ROM chip kit. Even with initial supply issues, the ZX was the first mass market home machine that could be bought from high street stores, with the previous 80 only available through mail order. This increased access and lower price, coupled with the success of the 80, meant the 81 would sell over 1.5 million units before it was discontinued in 1984. Now, back in 1981, this was a massive number, and it lined Sinclair's pockets enough to go on to produce the Sinclair Spectrum in 1983. But if you want to know more about that, you can watch my 3-part review and then forget about this shameless plug. With such high numbers, however, came reliability issues, and stores such as WH Smith were known for ordering a third more machines than it sold, simply so it could provide replacements for disgruntled customers. Many of these problems were later attributed to the problematic power supplies. Sinclair's strategy for wooing potential buyers was a clever one. What we may perceive as the machine's weaknesses today were flaunted as huge selling points at the time. Before even the high street availability, Sinclair would often take out huge advertisements in popular magazines to appeal to the casual buyer and hobbyists alike, with features such as memory-saving keyboard commands marketed as eliminating a great deal of tiresome typing. The machine's limited ability was advertised as being the ideal way to ease your way into computing, with the ability to add expansions as your knowledge grew. This was even aided by supplying the complete course in basic programming manual written by Steve Vickers to poise the unit as something you could just order and then learn. The public saw these machines as a great way to understand this emerging technology whilst jumping onto the gaming bandwagon for the youngsters in the house, and that's exactly what Sinclair intended. Sinclair himself became a focal point, adding a human face to the business, with Sinclair Research portrayed as a small British company taking on the Japanese and American giants. This image was played on with Uncle Clive taking interviews and featuring in adverts throughout the 80s. The main attraction, however, was that low price. The ZX81 had been designed to meet a £70 price point, as the 80 had been designed to meet £100. This price was touted against other machines such as the Commodore PET and Apple II Plus, which was a whopping £630, 9 times the price of Sinclair's Micro. The price, which was based on the experience curve technique, that a product would be more profitable selling at twice its cost than 3 times. And this was the main reason the UK population was ahead of the Micro curve compared to the rest of the world. The technical shortcomings of a Micro were obvious, but this didn't deter people, nor did it prove to be a problem for those that bought the technology. Remember, this was at the start of the Micro scene, so many people didn't know what to expect anyway. And by the time they'd worked out what to do, either it was time to upgrade, or they just packed the machine away in a cupboard. The 1KB base RAM was pretty limited and offered a challenge for would-be programmers, with a full screen already consuming up to 793 bytes, system variables consuming 125 bytes, leaving only a few bytes for the actual program and any stacks needed to run on top of that. This didn't stop games like the remarkable 1Kzx Chess being released, however, which packed a working game of chess into just 672 bytes, AI opponent included. For other games, the 16KB expansion pack came in handy and was a very popular add-on. Either way, many people cut their teeth on Sinclair's Basic, and it was from this resource that we end up with so many of these ZX81's game pool. Let's dive into some of my favourites. 3D Monster Maze. Kzx Chess. Kzx Defender. Flight Simulation. Volcanic Dungeon. Centipede. Crazy Kong. The Gauntlet. Amazingly, Dragon's Lair was recently converted for the ZX81 by ex-ocean coder Jim Bagley. Squeezed into just 32 kilobytes of memory and feeding from a ZX spanned SD card adapter, it might be using new technology to feed the data, but it's still a humble ZX81 doing the work here. Amazing! There was a sound expansion for the ZX81. However, most software was noise-free, as the base hardware even lacked an onboard speaker. However, through its life, clever tricks came to pass, including clever use of switching between fast and slow modes, which could induce tones in the video signal, and thereby create some crude sound synthesis. It was even possible to trick the system to display high resolutions of up to 256 by 192 through some clever mode switching. Thousands of ZX81 programs were published either as printed listings in magazines such as Sinclair Programs or on published cassettes from a number of upcoming software houses and bedroom coders, and this is the exact place we get amazing concepts like 3D Monster Maze. Scion, who would continue working with Sinclair, produced the aforementioned Flight Simulator, and ICL created over 100,000 cassettes in less than 3 months. The machine was also marketed in the States for just under $100. And initially, sales were pretty good until reliability issues took hold. However, it did well enough for Timex to license the design as the Timex 1000 and try to sell rebranded versions. These versions initially received huge interest, selling over 500,000 machines in 5 months and gaining Sinclair over $1 million in royalties. However, despite the Timex version's increased 2 kilobytes of memory, late delivery on RAM pack upgrades coupled with ongoing reliability issues left many consumers disillusioned, especially given the lack of software this meant they could run. It also became evident that the US market was more interested in pre-packaged software and games rather than education and learning basic programming, and the upcoming VIC-20 would solve both of those concerns. Other unofficial ZX81 clones would appear in Brazil, China, and Argentina, and some even improved on the hardware. Throughout its life, a vast line of expansions and printers, such as the crude but cheap Spark printer, which used black aluminium paper to zap text onto, came out for the ZX81, and ultimately the machine paved the way for the incredible Sinclair Spectrum launched in 1983. The machine had a massive impact on the UK market, and its legacy lasts in the UK development scene, which is still thriving to this day. As for Sinclair, the company's profits rose from £818,000 to almost £9 million after the 81's launch, and Clive became one of the highest profile businessmen in the UK, earning him a knighthood and Young Businessman of the Year in 1983. It's ironic that he didn't really know how to use his own machines then. Still, arise, Sir Clive. You deserve it. Thank you very much for watching this system review on the Sinclair ZX81. Plenty more in the past, plenty more to come in the future. Click one below, contribute to my Patreon, or just leave. In any case, thank you for watching, and have a good night.